Earlier, he was on deputation as Assistant Commissioner, Deputy Assessor and Collector in South Delhi Municipal Corporation. Dr. Sahdev Singh did his MA in History and LLB from Delhi University. Then he went to Malta and London to do his LLM in International Maritime Laws from IMLI. He has also done postgraduate diplomas in constitutional law, parliamentary procedures and institutions and international law and diplomacy. In brief, Mr. Singh has got various degrees of MA, LLB, LLM, postgraduate diploma in constitutional law, postgraduate diploma in parliamentary institutions and procedures, postgraduate diploma in international law and diplomacy, and parliamentary fellowship. Being so much educated and an intellect, he has attended many short courses, meetings, workshops, and conferences at various renowned institutions and educational centers. He visited about 10 countries. In recent past, he was working as Under Secretary, Ministry of Human Resource Development in the Government of India. In the Ministry of Shipping, Dr. Sahdev Singh was dealing with matters relating to maritime shipping and navigation, lighthouses, national waterways, ports, etc. However, in the Department of Higher Education, in the Ministry of Human Resource Development, Dr. Sahdev Singh was dealing the matters relating to universities. He was also dealing with the matters of NSC and Indian Research Councils, that is ICSSR, ICPR, ICPHR, etc. Dr. Sahdev Singh has delivered lectures as visiting faculties at Indian Maritime University, Chennai, to LLM students and Central University of Gujarat, Gandhinagar, regarding environmental law to MPhil and PhD students. Recently also got many honorary philosopher of doctorate and honorary doctorate of laws awards from different universities, organizations in various fields. Recently, Dr. Sahdev Singh has also been nominated as honorary professor at the board of International Internship University, IIU for India. Even during this COVID pandemic period, attended delivered lectures in many webinars. According to John C. Maxwell, I quote, a leader is one who knows the ways, goes the ways, and shows the ways, unquote. Dr. Singh is a leader who has always tried to do the right things in the right direction. He has tried to create a vision that is inspiring either directly or indirectly to coach his team and make them stronger. Thus, his leadership style has always created an inspiring vision for the future, motivated and inspired his juniors, colleagues, and known to engage with his vision and work effectively to achieve the vision. Dr. Singh has proved himself as a leader who wishes and works for society, regardless of his wondrous achievements. Engaging in community service provides me the opportunity to become active members of their community and has a lasting positive impact on society at a large, said Dr. Singh while talking to me. Community services or volunteerism enables me to acquire life skills and knowledge as well as provide a service to those who need it most, he added. On asking about his vision for life, Dr. Singh said, my personal vision is to have a life of meaning for myself and others. It is important to me to live my life in a way that shows kindness, care, and concern for families and friends and even strangers. His journey is not ends here, but anytime he is likely to be promoted as Deputy Secretary to the Government of India. So let us welcome Dr. Singh with a huge round of applause.
Thanks a lot, Navnita, and you appreciated a lot about me, and so thank you very much to invite me here to the live webinar. Am I audible now?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Yeah. Oh, thank you. So for inviting me to this live webinar on cyber threat in post-pandemic world, that is organized by this our MSME and Startups Forum Bharat. So really, I am feeling very confident and very proud of just having to this discussion on this platform. I'm also very much thankful to our this counterpart, today's speaker, Sri Sandeep Sen Guptaji. He's a director of Indian School of Anti-Hacking. And also I'm thankful to Madam this Srimati Ashok Kalraji. She is the National Vice President Public Relations in MSME Startup. And also I am very much thankful to this Mr. Sagar, who has traced me from this our one friend. He's Mr. Amit Agrawal, Sumit Agrawal. He's very nice people. So once again, I am also thankful to all the members and delegates who are just participating in this August webinar. Really, this topic is very excellent one in today's scenario. And also, I'm very feeling proud of this logo of this our this MSME Bharat, connect, create, and collaborate. Really, how wonderful it is. And this the hatch word they selected now, the Atmanirbhar Bharat, and our this government's main logo of this vocal for local. That is really, really very wonderful. So I'm once again thankful to all people who are present here and to inviting me for such an event. Thank you once again. So today's discussion in this webinar, the main issues are, what can you do to increase cyber readiness of your business? What are common areas of exposure to cyber threats? How to improve breach response? What are new threats are out there after the pandemic? And also the adoption of evolving the technology. So that is the view which I have given, for which this webinar today is conducted by this our MSME Startups Forum Bharat. So now let us discuss about these cyber security threats. Am I audible too now?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Thank you. Now Mandalji also I have seen now. Huh? very good. So now I have to just elaborate on these questions which we have just to discuss on today. So as a society shifts to being becoming more, cybersecurity is one such thing that is most important in light of the global, especially during this current year, this pandemic. The social changes brought about this COVID-19, including the movement of a large portion of workforce to telework and expansion of e-commerce footprints, has caused many companies to implement new IT capabilities ad hoc. And again, this such type of technology also become a much bigger and more lucrative target for the cyber criminals. As now we are working on totally IT-based workers, just in the lockdown period, we had started to work from home. So that is totally depending on the electronic media, electronic mode, internet connectivity, email connectivity. So how do we have to secure the threats on these modes? That is the main issue to working for many small and medium-sized companies. That is the main purpose for this platform for which it is found. They have not been sufficiently prepared for these upsurges in sophisticated cyber attacks, and much progress is needed to raise cyber security awareness. In this situation, we can suggest some following necessary action which can be taken by the this medium small enterprises or companies. For that, the employee should be provided with a license to antivirus and malware software for use on their personal computers. So by that way, we can store our data on our computers. Not only this, the employee should be vigilant when receiving emails and should check the authenticity of the sender's address. That is the most crucial part of this internet connectivity, especially during this work from home period. So companies should regularly evaluate cybersecurity risk exposure and determine whether existing controls are robust enough. New cyber risks that appear during the pandemic must be understood. For instance, security experts will need to scrutinize the digital capabilities of critical business functions, making sure they can withstand cyber attacks during a lockdown period. Companies with strong and current their cybersecurity plans should consider incorporating lessons from the contingency operations brought about the pandemic. Not only this, we can highlight here the awareness of the powerful antidote to protect from a social engineering attack. Coach all employees to take these precautions, particularly on their mobile devices. Last note, but least, we can also say that you can avoid harm from COVID themes. COVID-19 theme phishing with these cyber scams with skepticism, training and technical safeguards. Today's IT and network capabilities have enabled the strategy that have kept many companies afloat during this pandemic period. The current crisis, however, has highlighted the need to prepare to severe business disruption. The post-pandemic recovery and preparation period presents the opportunity for companies to rebuild to a new normal with enterprise resilience as a pervasive goal. So we can say that companies need to make their remote working practices resilient to cyber attacks and enhance their development and application of security measures. So I can now say again to thanks all the delegates, participants, and especially to our this MSME, this startups Forum Bharat, to invite me for such an event, especially during this crucial issue after this pandemic, COVID-19. So once again, I am very much thankful to all the MSME team here, especially just I have seen here that Vishwajit ji also, and Madam Ashu Kalraji, and your host, I have seen that Navnita Patnaik and Sagar Mandal as well. So once again, I'm very much thankful for such an event you have managed. Thank you. And wish you all the best during this this pandemic period. Kindly take care, take safe. Thank you once again.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you for such a wonderful insight. So, thank you, sir. So now I would like to request our next guest of honor, Mr. Sandeep Sengupta ji, who is a certified ethical hacker of EC Council, lead auditor and tutor, and British standard with 17 years of experience in IT, cybersecurity, working in India, New Zealand, and Singapore. His domains are vulnerability analysis and penetration testing, security audit, privacy audit, ITGC audit, PCI DCSS implementations, risk analysis and mitigation, IT security training, etc. He has been a speaker at CEBIT International Conference, CII Annual Events, FICCI, NASCOM, etc., several renowned places. Besides this, he has trained Kolkata Police and Anti-Cyber Crime Cell, Lal Bazar Headquarters as well. Also, he has been featured on the Telegraph, News Times, and Hackers Library, etc. So please welcome Mr. Sandeep Ji with a big round of applause. Sandeep, sir?
Yes.
Thank you.
Very good evening. A very good evening to Dr. Singh. Nice opening to the session. It is very good that you have brought up a lot of critical issues, which I will try to address in my session. And thank you, Navneeta Madam, Kalra Madam, and Sagar, for inviting me into this session. Thanks to MSME Startup Forum. I can see 50 plus people who are present over here. So it's an honor for me to come and present in front of you people. Now, I am an ethical hacker, and I work very closely with the police and the CID department. So lots of case studies comes to me, and I will try to share my experience and lot of live demo I will try to give to you, to give you an idea that how vulnerable people are and how and where the cyber criminals can attack you and steal data from you, steal money from you. So let's start with a live demo. I'm sharing my screen. I believe my screen is visible.
Yes.
Thank you so much. So see, let's start with a very small demo. How many of you save your password like this? So whenever you log into the site like Facebook, Instagram, Gmail, or even your office ERP, CRM, that password is already saved in the browser and there are asterisks over there. So you just have to click on login to get into the website. If you save your password like this, it is only 2 seconds to retrieve the password. Over here, I can see the password because they have given me an option, but most of the websites, they do not give this option. So you think that it is quite safe to save the password, and you can just click on login to log into your account. So you don't have to type the password again and again. If that is something what you have been doing, just see what I'm doing. I'm taking my mouse. If you see it for any of your friends or relative or family members who has done this, just show him this demo. Just take your mouse on that password, ***, asterisk, right click. You will see there is something called inspect. Click on inspect and immediately a code window opens where 3 lines of code are already selected. The third word in that selected code is input type equal to password. Change that password into text, text, enter, close this window and the password is visible. So if I change the input type from password password to text, text, immediately that password will be displayed to me. So that is something very dangerous. So never save your password like this. If you save your password like this, the password can be stolen within 2 to 3 seconds, not more than that. Unfortunately, we see that a lot of companies got hacked. And like, I'll just give you some idea. If you are using Truecaller, Truecaller got hacked in 2013. You see that Truecaller reportedly hacked 1 million Indian users at risk. if you have used Ola, then Ola was hacked and millions of credit card information was stolen. Recently, you have seen that Domino Pizza. So Domino Pizza account got hacked. So the 1 million credit card information was leaked into the internet. Even if you look into Zomato, you will see Zomato got hacked and 17 million Indian users were at risk. Unfortunately, Air India also got hacked. And there are at least 44,500,000 credit card details, passport details were leaked into the internet. So it's not like that only the small companies are suffering. Even the big companies are also facing a lot of problem. And people like us, we go to like hundreds of clients to keep them secured from these cyber criminals. And it is not that the cyber criminals are only inside India. They are outside India. And we are suspecting like if the third world war starts, most likely it will be a cyber warfare. It will be a digital warfare. And it will not be fought with guns. So not just to protect your money, just to protect your country from the foreign terrorists, from the different groups, the cyber criminals who are trying to harm this country from outside, you need to follow some digital hygiene. So I will try to just mention what type of digital hygiene you need to maintain, so that not only your data is safe, your money is safe, but the country itself is safe from getting hacked by some external agency who are continuously hammering into the digital infrastructure of the country. And sooner or later, if we do not improve, if we do not get this awareness, our country will fall. And that is something which is very dangerous. So try to understand. If you somehow do not understand, you write in the chat window, because last 10 minutes I will pick up questions. Any question you have, you can keep on writing in the chat window. I will go through the chat window and I will try to answer the questions that you have, and I will try to give you a solution to any problem that you write over there. Right. Let's start from something very elementary. I believe all of you use Gmail. The first thing that I come to hear every day from one or more person, that sir, my Gmail account got hacked. And there is a very easy way to make your Gmail hack proof. So let's see how you can do it. Suppose this is my Gmail account. If you go into the top corner, you will see there are 9 dots. Click on accounts. Again, I'm showing you. If you go to your Gmail login, to your inbox, you will see at the top right corner, there are 9 dots. You click on those 9 dots and the first option that comes is account. Click on account and you will come to this page. The moment you come to this page, you will see on the right hand side, you have something called security. Click on security. The moment you click on security, scroll down and you will see there is something called two-step verification. Now, this two-step verification means if you keep in switch on, even if a hacker knows your ID password, there will be an OTP which will be generated and it will come to your mobile. So what you have to do? You have to click on this two-step verification. They will ask you for your mobile number. Put your mobile number over there and then you enable it. By default, every Gmail account, this is by default switched off. So if you have to switch it on. So you can switch it on only after you put your mobile number over there. The moment you put your mobile number and change it to on, the OTP will start coming to your mobile the moment you give your ID password to Gmail. So even if somebody has hacked into your, he knows your ID password, he cannot hack into your account because the OTP will never go to his mobile. It will always come to your mobile. Not only that, if you get to see that a lot of OTPs are coming to your mobile, immediately it gives you an alert that somebody is trying to hack into your Gmail account. So please switch on this OTP in your Gmail, because most of us are using Gmail as our primary account. Now, not only Gmail, if you go into the, Facebook account, again, this is my Facebook account. Most of you will have a Facebook account either for business or for a business page or for branding, promotion, or just for chatting with your family. And I have seen this has become the highest, the number of attacks happens on the Facebook, because if they can hack into your Facebook account, they start sending messages to your friend asking for money, asking for information, sending some vulgar messages, trying to befriend some girls, and then it will be a reputation loss for you. And if somebody, some friend of yours, give money to that person, then that money will be lost. So again, there is a OTP feature in Facebook. And keep in mind, this OTP doesn't charge you any money. These are all free service. So if you go to Facebook and you go to this top corner, see, there is an arrow. At the top right corner, if you log into Facebook, there will be an arrow. Click on that arrow. There is a drop down. In the drop down, there is something called setting and privacy. Click on setting and privacy, and you will come to setting. Click on setting, and immediately you will be taken to a new page. Okay, this is taking some time. Again, I'm doing it. Okay, now it has come. So if you click on the settings and privacy and setting, you will come to this page. Go to again to the right hand side and see there is something called security and login. If you scroll down, you will again come to two-factor authentication. You enable this two-factor authentication and nobody can hack into your Facebook account. You can just put your mobile number over there and you can enable this. Immediately OTP will come to your mobile whenever you try to log into Facebook. So if a hacker knows your ID password somehow, he can steal the ID password, still he cannot log in into your Facebook account because the OTP will never go to him. It will always come to you. If you have any question, you can write in the chat window. I'll take all the chat messages after I complete my session. Otherwise, it will be a distraction for me and I will get lost in answering the questions. So most likely I will answer all the questions while I go through the session. And at the end, I will always come back to the chat window and I'll answer all the questions. If you have anything, any question in mind, write in the chat, I will look into all the questions and I'll answer them. Right. So now see, this Facebook and Gmail, I hope you know, you have understood how to protect it. And the same thing is there in your LinkedIn account, in your Instagram account. And if you have installed a CRM or ERP in your company, you call your vendor and ask them to enable this. Otherwise, the same problem can happen over there. Somebody can log into that cloud-based ERP or CRM knowing the ID password. So if they put an OTP function over there, then that will be can be taken care of. Other than that, the same concept is there in WhatsApp. If you go to WhatsApp, go to settings, go to accounts, you will see the two-factor authentication is there. Just go to WhatsApp, go to settings, go to accounts, and immediately you will see two-factor authentication feature is there. Just go over there, give a PIN number over there, and enable the two-factor authentication. Because again, I am seeing a lot of WhatsApp account getting hijacked. So if you enable the two-factor authentication, nobody can hijack that what your WhatsApp account. Right. Now coming to my slides. The cybercrime has gone up almost 200% since the lockdown. You know what has happened? When people were forced to stay within the home, they got bored and they have nothing else to do. So what they did, their entire life was forced to a digital life. Their only mode of entertainment, mode of reaching out to people was through that small mobile that they are carrying, maybe a smart mobile. But again, the people who are carrying the smart mobile may not be smart at all. So we are not doing everything smart with that smart mobile. So what these people have done, they have downloaded a lot of things, a lot of apps into that mobile, entertainment app, astrology app, games app, and they have given it to their children. And in fact, the children, they're also in big trouble. Why? Because previously used to say, tell the children that please do not use your mobile, go out and play with your friends. Now the entire 16 hours, they're not sleeping. They're awake their entire life is with the mobile. You don't talk to the kids. The only thing that the kids do is working on the mobile. And you never know what do the kids do on their mobile. So this has become very dangerous. Before I proceed, let me show you something. This is something which you may not be aware of. Till now, whatever internet you have seen, is called the surface wave. So whatever Google, you have used Google, you have used Gmail, you have used Facebook and social media. Till now, whatever you have done, that is only 5% of the internet. That is called the surface wave. That is visible wave. That is 5% of the internet. The remaining 95% of the internet you have never seen in your life. That is called the deep wave. That is below the wave, below the surface. To access deep wave, you need a special browser called Tor browser. Then only you can open the deep wave, dark wave. I will just give you some idea. Like this is a deep wave site. It's a hidden site. And if you look into this deep wave site, I mean, there are dangerous sites. In fact, if you look into, see, there are sites like even Hitman Network. So even like an online supari killing. And there are drugs, porn, you can buy guns over there. This entire site is a marketplace of drugs. And these are all the dark wave, deep wave sites. So anything below the surface wave is called the deep wave. And a special part of that deep wave where online crime is going on is called the dark wave. These sites are very dangerous sites. If you go to these sites, might happen that your machine gets infected with a malware, with a virus. And God knows what is going on over there, right from the drug market to the arms market and terrorists, everybody is playing over there. So if you want the link, I can share the link with you. You can open this link with your normal browser. But if you want to go any further, then you need a Tor browser, because if you click on this particular link, it will not open in the Chrome or Firefox or Mozilla or even that new Microsoft browser. You need a Tor browser to open these links. But this page you can open. You can even explore this page, but further you cannot go. The moment you click on these links, it will say, "Hey, I cannot open the link." You can go to Tor, Google and download the Tor browser and you can open that. But these sites, I don't recommend you people to open. So, but you need to know that this is something what is going on. All the data money that you are losing, that is getting sold at the dark wave, deep wave. And this is something which is completely unknown to you. So you are always on the surface wave, the 5% of the wave, 95% of the wave is the dark wave, deep wave, which is unknown to you. You have not explored that. Unfortunately, your kids are smarter than you. And they already know this dark wave, deep wave, and they are exploring dark wave and deep wave, and many of them are getting into trouble. So always speak to the kids and tell them that they should not visit the dark wave, deep wave, and keep a track what these people are doing with their mobile. There are a lot of software applications which you can use in the mobile of the kids to keep a track what these people are doing. You can even check the browser history, what they are doing with their mobile. Otherwise, you know what happened? These people are immature. They are curious. They are adventurous, but they are not very mature. They are very smart, but they don't have the experience and maturity that you people have. So once they go into the dark wave, deep wave, they can get into serious trouble. And they know how to do it. They are technically very sound. So try to talk to them and try to keep a watch on what these people are doing in their mobile. Coming to my slides. Let us see one by one, what are the downfalls, what are the pitfalls, which you can be aware of and you can stop the loss of data. Let's start with the mobile. Dr. Singh has very rightly said that this is the weakest device we have, our mobile. See, if we talk about our entire daily life, right from the morning we wake up until we go to sleep, how much time we spend with the laptop, desktop, and how much time we spend with the mobile? You will see almost 60-70% time we spend with the mobile, not with the laptop, desktop. So the cyber criminals also know that if we want to attack, we should make some innovative attack, some software application, malware, whatever is needed. Everything is now focused to the mobile. They are not devoting their times in laptop, desktop. The single point of attention is your mobile. And the mobile is the most vulnerable, and I will prove that to you. So if I take a survey at this moment, how many of you have installed an antivirus in your mobile? The answer will be not more than 50%. If I ask you how many of you have installed an antivirus in your laptop, desktop, the answer will be 99%. Everybody has installed an antivirus in your laptop, desktop, but almost 40% or 50 or 60% people have not used any antivirus in your mobile, while everything you are doing through mobile and not through laptop, desktop. And the same malware, the same type of attack, the same type of cybercrime, the attack vectors that you see on the laptop, desktop is still applicable in the mobile. And the mobile is the most vulnerable. Attack is increasing more and more into the mobile. And that is the device you have completely kept it open. So if you ask me what type of things I will put into the mobile, you can go to this particular software, Lookout. You can go and check this software, Lookout app. This is a nice app to protect the mobile. Again, when you go for downloading an app, there you will see there is one genuine app and 10 fake apps over there. You need to know which app is the genuine app. So how will you find out? That also I will show you. So this Lookout, L-O-O-K-O-U-T, this is a nice app which you can install in your mobile. And this is a nice security app for your mobile. So let's see how to keep this your mobile protected. So suppose you have gone, you are trying to install an app in your mobile, because every software that you install in your mobile is basically an app application. So if you want to download and install an app in your mobile, what are the golden rules that you need to follow? Let us see. Let us put it into a notepad. The first thing that you need to keep in mind while you install any app into your mobile, I don't know why it is so slow, but yeah. Right. So the first thing that you need to keep in mind, only download from App Store and Play Store. Never ever install any app which comes through email, comes through our website, comes through WhatsApp, comes through some chat messenger. Somebody asks you to download from any other communication channel. Never ever install any app other than Play Store and App Store. Why? Because Play Store and App Store, when they upload the app over there, they do a basic level security checking. So a straightforward malware can never get uploaded over there. So if you only download from App Store and Play Store, then at least there is a first level checking that this is not a malware. I have heard even today some, I don't know, I mean, if you are from Calcutta or not, I have in the afternoon, I was live on ABP. So I gave a statement over there that somebody has sent a app on WhatsApp and asked a lady to install it. The moment the lady has installed that app in the mobile, the entire mobile got hijacked and the OTP got stolen and at least 70,000 rupees was lost. So never ever install an app which comes directly to you. Even if somebody advises you to install an app, just like I have advised you to install Lookout. Go to App Store, go to Play Store, find out, search for that particular app and then only install it from there. Now, the moment you go to App Store, Play Store, you will see there are 10 apps with the same name. So how to know which one is the genuine app and which one is the fake app? So to find out, it is very easy. See the number of downloads, ratings and the review. If it's a genuine app, you can expect at least 10,000 to 50,000 downloads over there. If you see that it has only 5-6 downloads or 10 or 20 downloads and a rating of maybe done by 20-30 people, definitely it's a fake app. Don't download it. And always go and see the review, because if somebody has downloaded that app and suffered, he will come back and give a bad review over there. So if you look into the review, if before installing the app, you will come to know a lot of things about that app, and that can alert you whether not to go ahead. Secondly, when you install an app, always try to find out what type of permission the app is asking. If the app is asking for permission of microphone, webcam, your your album, your location, your SMS, your contact list. Stop. Don't install it if it is not a very, very popular app and you cannot live without that app. Think of it. If an app is taking permission of the SMS, are you not giving full access of your OTP to that app? Because OTP is nothing but SMS. So if you are giving access to the SMS to any app, most likely you have given all app permission to your SMS, then basically your OTP, which is your last line of defense for any banking transaction, then that is compromised. So be careful about what you have given permission. Now, if you have already installed a lot of apps in your mobile, go to the setting, go to the app manager, go to the permission setting, and you will see for every app, there is a slider on which permission you have given to the app. Just move the slider and remove that permission to that particular app. It will work perfectly fine. I guarantee you. So try to remove unwanted permission given to an app. And before you install, try to see that what type of permission given. Do not give permission to SMS to any app. If not, it's a very, very popular and reputed and trusted app. Coming to the next one, the home Wi-Fi password. Very important that you change the Wi-Fi password. Any password needs to be changed. Why? Because using a brute force technology, I can break into a password within 30 days. So whatever password you have given to the local Wi-Fi, please change it every 30 days. Otherwise, somebody gets hacks into that Wi-Fi password using a tool called Ethereal, or it's nowadays it is called Wireshark. They can see all data which is passing through the network. So if you like, when I go to a hotel, I never connect to the hotel Wi-Fi. So I also did this experiment. You go to a hotel like Ashok, and I am a hacker. I create a Wi-Fi Ashok 1. You know what happens? Hundreds of people immediately connect to it. And the moment they connect to my Wi-Fi, I can see what data they are transferring, and I can see everything. So it's better that if you go to a hotel or a CCD or an airport, only connected to your mobile hotspot, not to an outside public network, because immediately if there is a hacker sitting over there, he can see all the data that you are transferring through that Wi-Fi network. And for your personal home Wi-Fi, try to change the password, or somebody else will connect to it and they will be able to see whatever you people are transferring that data onto the network. Not only Wi-Fi password, change the CCTV password. All those people who can see the CCTV from mobile, from remotely, please change the CCTV password. Otherwise, if you can see that password from your mobile, what is going on inside your office or your house, why will the hacker not be able to? He can brute force and break into that password. So whatever you are doing inside your house, he can see remotely. He can take a MMS clip. He can see where you keep your money in your office at your home. So if you don't change your CCTV password every 30 days, you better always be in a very formal dress in your house because somebody is watching. Right. Next point is external hard disk. If you have any external hard disk or pen drive, try to encrypt it. There is a nice tool for encryption, which is called Veracrypt. This is a free tool. You can download it. Veracrypt. Try to keep your pen drive, your external hard disk encrypted. Why? If you lose it, somebody will pick up and they will find whatever you have put over there. You can put your photo over there. You can put your confidential information over there. And you don't want those information to go to somebody else. So make sure that you encrypt that data, your pen drive, your hard disk, so that if somebody get access, if you lose it, if somebody picks up that pen drive, that data, that photo, that data, that file, that confidential information will not go to the other party. Similarly, if you sell if you give your pen drive to somebody else, always erase the data from there. Now, we have a belief that if we do a formatting, the data is erased. That is not. Hard disk doesn't have any mechanism to erase data. What does it mean? If you do a factory reset or do a shift del or do a del, hard disk basically marks that space within the hard disk as empty. And when new data will come, it will fill up that empty space, and then the hard disk will again become full. When new data overwrite the old data, then only that old data is lost. Otherwise, if you just do a delete and give me that pen drive, I will use forensic tool to retrieve every information that you thought is deleted. So if you want to delete the data, there are nice tools called DBAN, D-B-A-N. Again, it's a free tool. You can use this tool to overwrite automatically all the data, because manually it becomes very difficult. If you use this type of automated tools, then it will overwrite the entire hard disk space with garbage data, and then only the old data will be gone and nobody can retrieve your confidential photo or files from that pen drive or camera SD card or your DSLR SD card or your mobile SD card or your even external hard disk. If you want to give it to somebody, always erase. Even if you want to give it to a service center, erase. Use this free tool, DBAN. Especially with the mobile, which you go for a mobile exchange offer or you sell it to somebody, every bit of photo that you have taken through that mobile can be immediately retrieved and can be used for a wrong reason. We always suggest that Alexa should be switched off during the confidential meeting because it is always listening to whatever you are saying. And we have seen that instances where this has been leaked out. So keep the Alexa switched off. Even your mobile hotspot, try to switch it off when you are going to sleep. Because if you switch the mobile hotspot on, some hacker can brute force, try to break into it. And sooner or later, he will break into it. So why give him that time? When you are not using the mobile hotspot, switch it off so that nobody has access to it. Right. Ransomware. If you are using any of these tools, AnyDesk, TeamViewer, please do not use in your mobile and laptop or desktop. If you need it for any purpose, use it and uninstall it, because these are the tools which are used by hackers to take a remote access to hijack your mobile or your laptop or desktop. So try to avoid this AnyDesk and TeamViewer tool. There is nothing wrong with these tools, but they're used for the wrong reason. So if you, even if you have this AnyDesk TeamViewer, try not to share the PIN number with the with somebody over the phone. See, the golden rule of OTP, the golden rule of OTP is that OTP should never be shared over phone. If you follow this rule, never ever you will get a banking transaction theft. OTP you can put on a website, put in an app, you can tell the OTP to an Ola Uber driver, but never ever share the OTP over the phone. 100 out of 100 case, OTP is never asked over the phone. I'm telling you, guarantee. If somebody is asking you OTP or any PIN number over the phone, it's a fraud case. Don't do it. The moment somebody asks you over the phone, get alert. This is a fraud. This guy is a criminal. This guy is a hack, unethical hacker. Do not search on Google for help desk number. Again, this has become very predominant. A lot of hacking is going on recently. So what this is about, see, most of the sites that you see on Google on the search list, higher up on the rank, they are fraud sites. So I got two instances which I want to discuss with you. Since the lockdown, people are buying a lot on the e-commerce site. How do I know whether the e-commerce site is a genuine or a fake? So if you want to buy it from a very popular e-commerce site like Flipkart or Myntra, I don't have anything to say about it. But what happened, just one case study I will share with you. Just when the lockdown started, all the popular sites, N95 mask was not available. So what happened, people started searching on Google and there are small e-commerce sites which said that we have a stock of N95 and these are all fake sites. So people put a lot of money over there because cash on delivery, people are not accepting. So they have paid through credit card, debit card, and they lost the money. So how to know whether the site is a genuine or not? There's a very easy way to find out. Go to the site, go to the refund policy or contact us number, call that phone number, or just give a missed call to the phone number. 100 out of 100 fake e-commerce site, that phone number is not working because they continuously get hammered by people who are getting, scammed. So that number is never working. So if you want to buy from an e-commerce site and you call that contact us number or the refund complaint number, and you see that the number is unreachable, 100 out of 100, it's a fake site. Don't do any e-commerce transaction over there. And if you want to search on Google, like I saw that a lot of people are searching on Google how to get my SBI ATM debit card activated, or how to solve this problem on WhatsApp. I mean, people keep on searching because people, you people only trust two people in this world, your mom and google.com. So that's very unfortunate. You can always trust your mom, but don't trust google.com. Why? Because hackers know that people blindly trust google.com. So they have made search engine optimized sites which come up on Google high ranking, and these sites are completely fraud sites. So the moment people search on Google and they see the site and they call the customer support number, like how to solve this problem. This has happened even today in Calcutta. Somebody searched on Google, my SBI ATM card is not working, and they reached a particular fake site. They called the toll-free number. The toll-free number was basically a hacker's number. That person said, I can help you out. And then that person lost a lot of money. So please do not blindly trust a number, site which comes up higher rank on the Google. And definitely don't call that number that which is displayed on the site and trust whatever that person is asking you to do. I'm not going into the scams. There are different types of scams which are going on. The Nigerian scams, the lottery scams, the job scams. If you get an email which talks about a job, any job offer, how do you know whether that is a genuine job offer or not? It's very easy. Nobody will send you a job offer from Gmail or Yahoo or Rediff Mail. I got some complaints from engineering students, says I have got an offer from Microsoft. So I asked him, where did you get this offer from? Microsoft, which email did it came from? It came from Rediff Mail. Microsoft will never send you an offer from rediffmail.com. So that is your alert. Sometimes they do us email spoofing. That means they send from as if from the Microsoft ID, but just do a reply. The moment you do a reply, it will go to Gmail or Rediff or Yahoo Mail. Immediately, you know it's a fraud. It's a scammer. And nowadays, they are even scamming on WhatsApp, on SMS. Please do not click anything on the WhatsApp, on the SMS, because most of these links have malware. The moment you click on it, it goes to a phishing site. It goes to a site which will immediately drop a virus into your laptop, desktop, or mobile. So do not trust these links. In fact, unfortunately, what I see that every day, you wake up in the morning and for another 2 hours, you see all the good morning messages, PDF, video, link, photo. People keep forwarding these links and you also forward it to 100 of your friends. This is completely stupid. I mean, you don't trust where it is come from. Some hacker will start a malicious PDF file and then will send it on the WhatsApp that this is what has happened in God knows which place. Some Shahrukh Khan is dancing, you want to see. And you click on that, you send it to 100 friends, they get hacked, you get hacked. Please do not forward this on the WhatsApp. Good morning message, if you want to wish somebody good morning, write a text, forward a text, don't forward a file, a link, an image, or a video. You have not created this video. Whoever has created the video have no clue who is the source, whether that person is a hacker or not. So stop forwarding the good morning messages till afternoon. And don't start forwarding the good night messages to everybody. You are actually infecting people who trust you. Call spoofing, SMS spoofing, email spoofing. Now, call spoofing is something I can make a call from any number to another number. They are using a technology called voice over IP. So now, even if you get a call, there is no guarantee that the call is a genuine call. And there are two cases where they are doing it. First case, they're calling the accountant of the company from the MD's number or the CFO's number or whoever senior person. And they're saying, what is the tender code? What is the code for the tender? Now that poor accountant, immediately he see the MD's number, MD is calling. He by panic, he is giving that information and immediately the tender is lost. Or sometimes they are getting a call, can you immediately shift some money to this account? And the call is coming from the CFO or the MD. Now, if you get a call like this at that time, your brain will not work. So what you have to do, very easy. If you get a call, you are very suspicious that it can be a fake call, just call back. Because if you call back, that guy has used voice over IP, you are using normal telephone. So your call will go directly to the normal person. And immediately the person will tell you that I have not made the call. So if you get a suspicious call like this, just disconnect, sir, I'm not being able to hear you properly. Let me allow me to call back. Moment you call back, you will get the idea that the person has done a fake call. Similarly, email spoofing. Again, email can be sent from any person's ID to any person's ID. Actually, I'm not using his email ID. I'm sending for my email ID, but I'm putting his email ID in the from field. So when you will get the email, you will see that the other person has sent the email. Well, I have sent the email. So the email is coming from the HR department with attaching a file that your HR appraisal. Email is coming from the tax department attaching a file that is your fund. So what will you do? Will you click? I will come a little bit about the banking frauds. So the point is, if you have a credit card, debit card, please do not allow this debit card. Do not give this. If you go to a restaurant or a petrol pump, do not give this card to a waiter or that person at the petrol pump. Why? Because if he takes photo of both the sites, he can make purchase in any e-commerce foreign sites without OTP, without PIN. I don't know whether you know this or not. Foreign e-commerce site do not need OTP PIN. So if I am doing a transaction in Amazon.com, I don't need a PIN OTP. I can send, just give me your credit card, front side, back side photo. I will make any purchase, 1 lakh rupees purchase. You cannot do anything. You cannot stop it. It doesn't ask you for any action. Immediately it goes through. So do not allow somebody to take a photo of the front and back side of your credit card. Not only that, don't allow that person to move that card in front of a CCTV, because that video recording is there and he can see everything from there. So don't allow the person, don't hand over the card to the person. You tell the person that you bring the POS machine in front of me, then only I will give you the card. And whatever you want to do, do it in front of me. And don't look at the backside of the card. You don't need that. And if you have a contactless card, how do you know contactless card? This is a wireless sign over there. Please make sure that you put it in an aluminium foil that you see in a sweet shop. Why? Because if I put a POS machine near to that card, till 2000 rupees can be deducted without PIN, without OTP. I will not go into this. This thing I want to give us some idea. If you really want to keep your people protected, you need to give awareness to the people. When we go for audit, say I have a lot of clients. I'm a consultant. I'm a security consultant. So I give consultancy to clients like Bandhan Bank, to Spencer, to CSC, to Tita Garwagans, Coca-Cola, ABP. These are all my clients. Even Tata Steel, Electro Steel, Vedanta, any client that you talk in Calcutta, I give consultancy to them. I have a huge base of clients in Calcutta and outside Calcutta, even abroad. Now, when I go for consultancy, the first thing that I focus in any company, give awareness to the people. Because if you have one person who is doing something stupid over there, that person will down the entire company. So before you spend on antivirus, firewall, anything, go and give awareness to the people. Firewall cannot save you. Only people can save you who are properly made aware what are the do and don'ts. And if you want, I have a link. You can explore this link. This is my website. And we have a link, handbook. Just a minute. /handbook.pdf. So this is a PDF that I have created. You can explore this PDF. I'll share the PDF. I have compiled each and every do and don'ts in this handbook.pdf. I'm just sharing it in the chat window. You can download this PDF file. This handbook.pdf, isuvh.com handbook.pdf, and you will see there is a huge list of do and don'ts. Whatever I'm telling you, I've compiled everything over there so you can know what are the things. And share it with your employees, with your family members, with your friends, because they also need to be protected. And I have also mentioned about kids, about home, about software development, about network. So I have made an exhaustive list. What are the things you need to do and not need to do in this handbook? Since I do not have time to mention each and everything, so I compiled a list of everything in this handbook. And if you click on this link, isuvh.com/handbook.pdf, you can immediately download. Just go to this top right corner, you can download it from there. Right. I think my time is up, so let me end over here. Let me see what are the questions you have put up in the chat window. Sagar, can you read out the question one by one so that I can answer?
Yeah, sure. Thank you so much for this amazing session. It was really a pleasure to host you, and it was really great. And many of the things I also didn't know, I also got to learn from you. And the Nigeria fraud once happened with me. Actually, it was going to happen when I was looking for some investment for my startup several years back. And that time I got a message from a Nigerian guy, and he said that, okay, I'll give you the funding. But later he asked me to transfer some amount to his account. And that time I got to know that, okay, that is a fraud. Actually, I was Googling about it, and then I found that many people also reported the same thing. The Nigerian people are doing this kind of scams. So it often happens. And thank you so much for the knowledge. And let's take some questions from the audience now.
I think most of the questions, yeah, please carry on.
Good evening, sir.
Yes, good evening.
It's me, Yuganta Anand. Yes, sir. Sir, I have a problem yesterday. It's about yesterday, sir. My Flipkart account has been hacked yesterday. And I have changed that password many times. But again and again, anyone will order from my Flipkart account many times. Many expensive things has been ordered.
Right, I got your point. What you can do,
I haven't.
Right. I understood your point. What you can do, you can just activate the OTP over there, and immediately that account will be protected. So the golden rule is activate OTP. If you cannot activate OTP, then the site has run the risk of getting hacked.
OTP has been already be activated. Every time OTP gets to my mobile, and every time he got that OTP, and he will order my any of the things like watches, smart watches, mobile phones, and every expensive things he has ordered.
So it might
I have cancelled many times, but also he have ordered me.
I understand your mobile might be had been compromised, so you take the mobile to a service center and get it checked.
Okay, sir. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Now, Kartik ji is asking, sir, how to enter password on Canara or SBI banking homepage and also on YONO mobile app from mobile and desktop?
So, I have neither Canara bank account or SBI. I really stay from SBI bank account because I believe that is the most I don't know. I mean, what is the answer? How to do this? But again, what I can say, if you face any banking fraud, the moment you come to know about it, just go to your local cyber cell, not the local police station. Go to the nearest cyber cell, lodge a complaint over there, take a sprint out of the bank statement. Take a printout of or the scan copy of that police general diary or FIR, whatever you manage to lodge in the police station. Go to the branch, write a covering letter that this is the money that has been lost. Please reimburse. Take two copies, get one copy submitted into the branch manager and get one copy stamped that accepted and retained with you. Bank will refund till 1 lakh rupees to you if you report within three days, and they will refund you that money till 1 lakh within 7 days. Now bank doesn't give that money. They give the money from the insurance. They also have fraud insurance from where they recover the money and they pay you back. So, but you have to do complain, follow these activities within 3 days. Can Windows virus infect Android phone? Well, Android has more virus than Windows. Why it doesn't have that? This has to have Windows virus. Look into Google, you will see that Android virus, there are thousands of Android virus which continuously attack the Android phone. So it is good to have a antivirus or that software lookout into your Android phone. I think we will conclude it over here. Sagar, over to you.
Yeah, so now next question is from Nobil ji. He's asking, my Facebook account was hacked, password changed and operated remotely without any notification or confirmation email or SMS. How is that possible?
I have no idea. I cannot. I have to ask Mark Zuckerberg because I get this question every day. My Facebook account got hacked. Only thing I know how to stop the hacking, but if something is lost, I have no idea how to do it. Even if you can recover the Facebook account, you start enable two-factor authentication. The moment you enable two-factor authentication, no way somebody can hack your Facebook. But if it has got hacked, then I mean, it's almost like a money stolen, thief is gone, and nobody, no way you can recover other than asking Facebook to, give it back to you. If you search Google, recover Facebook account, there will be some links where they ask you some questions. You answer those questions. Beyond that, nobody can help you.
Okay, got it. So Subhadip is asking, how can we make our own website secure?
Well, that you can check from the handbook. We have given a lot of points over there on how to secure your website. What are the things you need to keep in mind while you are doing your programming. Again, I'm sharing the link over here, iswitch.com handbook. Click on this link, download the PDF, and you will get a step-by-step guideline on what to do, what not to do with your software coding.
Okay, perfect. I will share it in our Facebook handle as well.
Right. So the next question is, what is the best place to run ethical hacking? I can tell you the best place to learn ethical hacking. We are teaching ethical hacking online. You can always come and join. This is our website. You can always contact this number, 900-739-2360. This is not my mobile number. This is the number of the person who handles the admission, and he will guide you. I can give you my number, but please contact me on WhatsApp. Don't call me because I am always in some sessions or not. So my number is 98303-10550, 98303-10550. But if you want to contact me on WhatsApp, and please do not ask me about how to recover Facebook account. I have no clue on that. I get 10 questions on that, on how to recover Facebook account, and I immediately surrender.
Yeah, I can understand. Okay, now everybody thinks that MacBook or iPhone are actually more secure than any other devices, but still, can MacBook or iPhone be hacked?
iPhone is much, much more secure than Android and Windows. But again, it depends on how you are handling it. If I'm using an iPhone, I am using an iPhone. So if I am using an iPhone and I download apps where I have given permission to each and everything in my iPhone handset, then obviously my iPhone can get compromised. So it all depends on how you handle the device. The device itself is fine as long as you are not rooting or jailbreaking it. But if I am installing the apps and giving permission, then that app can basically hijack my entire handset.
Okay. So we'll only take a few more questions now because we are running out of time. So someone is asking, what is synthetic identity fraud in bank or financial sector? And how we can prevent it from happening with us?
Can you copy paste the question in the chat window?
Yeah, sure.
Oh, it's coming from the Facebook, I believe.
Yes, from Facebook.
Can you copy paste? What is synthetic identity fraud? I don't have much idea, but identity fraud can be different types. So what I'm seeing, the trend, you people give a lot of documents while picking up the SIM card in your mobile. So suppose I go to a mobile shop to pick up a new SIM card, I'm giving my KYC documents, which can be my Aadhaar card, my voter ID card, my driving license. Now these are getting copied 100 times, and these are used to create fake accounts. And these accounts are used to create a new mobile number and also to create bank accounts. So that is happening, and that is very alarming. So I suggest that when you go and take a new SIM card, try not to share the Aadhaar card in that local shop. Don't give your Aadhaar card or very too much confidential information in the local shop, or go to a shop which is very reputed, not to a very small local shop where that KYC document you have given can be duplicated and used for identity theft. Somebody has asked a question, is ISWitch is endorsed by Government of India? Well, I closely work with this Center of Excellence, Government of West Bengal. I'm an advisor over there. So the our BSc Cybersecurity course, BSc Digital Forensic and BSc Cybersecurity and MSc Digital Forensic course are government affiliated, but there are a lot of skill-driven courses which are not affiliated by any government because Government of India don't affiliate this course. So the skill development course mostly at the global certification like CH, licensed penetration tester. These people either go for global certification or go for the UGC recognized bachelor's and master degree. So if you are choosing a BSc MSc, that is UGC recognized, that we offer. In fact, we offer the BSc in digital forensics. We are the only one in Eastern India, we are offering it. And we even trained the Kolkata police CID for that. And not only police, Calcutta police, we are also now got the project of Calcutta port. We will be training them. So a lot of government, even CRPF, we have given training, but UGC approved is only BSc, MSc, but other courses are global certification. Sagar, I think questions will keep coming. So
yeah, question will keep coming. We need to end this. So one last question I will get in taking. So the last question is that opening DMAT account information will cause to bank account hacking? Is there any connection between the DMAT account opening or bank hacking?
DMAT, it depends on how we have connected, because you know the DMAT account, sometimes you need to, when you buy a share, you need to pay from the same bank account. So you have any direct connectivity between the account, that can be a problem. But what I have seen, most of the people connect their credit card to the FD through a sweeping account. So whenever there is any fraud, the FD gets deducted with using a sweeping account. So that can be a problem. And otherwise, I would suggest that there are a lot of frauds which I can talk about. Sometimes if you are using a transactional debit card, try to keep a low balance over there. So I usually keep my money in FD or in some account which cannot be broken. And I keep a small amount of money which is connected to the debit or credit card. So if there is a breach, not much money can be lost. Don't keep 2 lakh, 3 lakh in cash in your savings account. Always keep a very minimum amount of money, maybe 30,000-40,000 rupees in your savings account, and the rest you put into the FD or some other account which cannot you don't usually use or expose to the outside.
Okay, great.
I think it's 23. I have to leave.
Yes, sorry. Yes. That's all for today. Thank you so much, sir, for hosting this amazing session. It was really a pleasure to have you. And it is so interesting. That's why we still have 58 participants with us. It was so engaging. Thank you so much once again.
Thank you. It's a pleasure and honor for me. Thank you so much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.